FHS Baccalaureate for the class of 2019. Thank you so much for being here. I want to thank the class for the eagerness to come and show up for an evening of worship together as you begin your life, the transition in your life to the next step. I do want to say thank you also to the school, the administration, Mr. Pierce, for helping out tonight. I know that not everyone had the opportunity to be a part of the service tonight, but I do want to thank the participants beforehand. They appreciate their willingness to be a part of this. And, of course, First Christian's Praise Band, thank you so much for being here and helping our worship tonight. We'll begin with a word of prayer, if you all will stand, and then some of the girls will do some scripture reading as we move through our service tonight. Let's go to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we come tonight, standing together, asking that you can be honored by what happens here. We thank you for your word of truth. We thank you, Lord, for your spirit that you have let be in our lives so that we can be an encouragement to one another, or that we can enjoy the presence of one another. And Lord, that we can stand for truth and be able to make decisions and have the freedom to follow you and to worship you. And we pray that tonight that you can be a blessing to this class as they move forward. Lord, we thank you for your providence in our life that have gotten them to this point, and we commend them over to you, praying that you will continue to guard them and keep them as they continue on through their life. But Lord, most important of all, we thank you for Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, for his example. We thank you for his sacrifice. We thank you for his purpose and the opportunity to get to know you and be in a relationship with you, not just now, but forever. You are to be praised. Through the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Mark 4:1-9. Again, Jesus began to teach by the lake. The crowd that gathered around him was so large that he got into a boat and sat in it out on the lake, while all the people were along the shore at the water's edge. He taught them many things by parables, and in his teachings, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched and they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants so that they did not bear grain. Still, other seed fell on good soil. It came up, grew, and produced a crop, some multiplying 30, some 60, some 100 times. Then Jesus said, "Whoever has ears to hear, let them hear."
Okay, Matthew 7:24-27. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the wind blew and beat against the house. Yet it did not fall, because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice, like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew and beat against the house, and it fell with a great crash. Matthew 6:33. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well.
All right, we'll let the band get set up. We are the praise band from First Christian Church. And I'm not sure how you guys worship at your church, but at ours, we all stand up and sing together. So I'm going to have you stand up while we sing these songs, and the words will be back here on the... Nope. Oh, the words are in the bulletin? Okay. The words are in the bulletin. The first song we're going to do is Confidence.
Face my giants with confidence.
sharing with us and keeping us focused. Excuse me just a moment. Even though we have an opportunity like tonight to look back and consider the amazing achievements and the amazing people that these graduates represent, it's always most important to be reminded that it's the Lord who's good and it's Jesus who has provided for us. So I appreciate you all helping with that. I asked my kids several times, I said, so what is it that you want me to say? Emma, right before we came tonight, I said, What do I need to say? She said, Dad, you know what I haven't done yet? I'm like, well, I do, so don't worry, but we'll be all right. But at the same time, I want to be able to say something memorable. You know, I want to give you something tonight as you gather together, as classmates, a chance to worship the Lord and consider what it is as you move along in this transition of life. I heard one person give such a speech, and they said, well, what I want to tell you is this. Remember where you came from. Yeah, that's really good. On several different levels, remember where you came from. And then my mind went and twisted it, as it usually does. I mean, we are from Clay County, right? So what I want to give you is a lesson from dirt. The Bible says, Genesis 2, that's where we came from. In the beginning, when God made Adam, he formed him out of dirt and breathed into his lungs, giving him life. So stay with me just a minute. But I do think there's some lessons there from dirt that you can find a challenge with in your life with Jesus. Let's look a little bit at the words that Jesus spoke, even in the parable that was read earlier, the parable of the sower. You know, maybe that's better known as, better named, the parable of the soils. Because the sower, all he does is scatter the seed. What makes a difference in that story is how the soil receives the seed. Jesus says that the farmer is scattering the seed back in the day before modern technology with a bag and using his hand. And as he did, some of that seed fell along the pathway. Jesus doesn't waste any time reminding us that the seed that falls on the path quickly is devoured. It doesn't last very long. Then he says that some of the seed falls across, some of it falls into the rocky soil. The plant begins to grow. And it goes into some detail there in the story that tells us as it's growing, because of the soil that the plant is in, it grows quickly but has no depth and fades away. The third seed, as it is scattered, falls into the thorns. And as it is there, it grows there within the thorns. But the problem is, as it grows, so does those weeds, and it chokes out the good seed that is there. One, two, three. What are you trying to tell us, Jesus? Then he tells us the last soil. He said the other seed falls on the good soil, and the plants there grow and provide a very fruitful harvest. There's some lessons that we can understand about who we are and the way that we receive the gospel of Jesus. It's one thing to grow up in a Christian family, to be in a community where there's so many churches, so many believers, that you can find encouragement in your faith. What happens next? What is it? How in your life are you going to be like that soil, one, two, three, or four, that'll make a difference on where you are? So I brought with me an illustration. Let's pretend that this is your life. Well, maybe not. We are talking about dirt. So let's pretend that this is your life. And our life is made up of several different things, right? The decisions that we make every day comes about. And it's things that fill us up that we have to decide where we're going to eat and where we're going to go and who we're going to talk to and what are we going to say and some of those kind of things. But at the same time, life is more complicated than just the simple, right? It gets to the point where there's relationships. And so let's let the sand resemble relationships, maybe that are a part of life. And as life comes around, there are so many decisions that we bump up against and people and conversations that we have. And some are good and some are bad. But at the same time, it still fills part of our life in that respect. And then, of course, there's the decisions that we make. simple decisions at first, decisions of what we want to study, or who we're going to go and be friends with, or what we're going to say when we're out in public. And some of these decisions, again, help make us into who we are as people. But also, as a part of life, we come into the big decisions, the values that we have, the character that we have, the integrity that we have. And unfortunately, sometimes as we go along with life, we find out that there's not necessarily a lot of room. A lot of people, unfortunately, live life this way, and that's why it becomes such an issue when young people go off into the next stage of their life. They're not sure what's going to happen, because the big issues that they grew up with, remember where you came from, is quickly to a point where there's not room to put in their life anymore, and so they make mistakes and make bad choices, and unfortunately, many turn away from their faith in Jesus. But it doesn't have to be that way, because there's a lesson here that I think that we can learn. And let me go ahead and get rid of that life for a moment. But let's consider this. There is a key that I think is important as we consider about our faith and those values that we have. But if we take these parts of our life, our belief in Jesus, the understanding of truth, the authority of Scripture, the experience and the example of those who have gone on before us, and we start by putting those things in our lives first, we find out that sometimes the most important thing that we can do, and here is something for you to take home tonight, is put the big rocks in first. Because when the big rocks go in, and then we have those relationships, and they kind of go in around it, and we have people that we talk to, and some go well, and some don't always go well. Make sure we get it all in there. And then we have those other choices that we make about where we go, and about what we're going to do, and who we're going to see, and who we're not going to see. And then we get to the point of all the little simple decisions that we make in life about where we're going to eat, and where we're going to go, and where we're going to spend our time. We find out that the reality is that life does fit. But the difference is, what's your priorities? Do you put the big rocks in first? Now, the reality is that you get to choose the rocks. You get to decide what are those values that you are not willing to give up. Hopefully, it is your faith. Hopefully, it is your family. Hopefully, it is the important things that form you with your morality and understanding what truth is. A few years back, I got to considering some of the big questions in life, like most people do, especially when they hit middle age. And I came up with four questions to ask. Maybe you're thinking, okay, well, what are my big rocks? Here are four questions I want you to consider. Where do you come from? Well, we already talked about how we came from dirt. But the other part of that passage in the book of Genesis is that as God creates Adam and Eve, it says he creates them in the very nature and likeness of God. That gives us value. That's why we love people. That's why all people are important. That's what causes us to be generous and to be sharing in other people's lives. Because they have value as children of God, made in the image and likeness of God. You have to ask yourself that question, though. Where do we come from? Am I a product from God, or am I a mass of cells? Am I the neurons that flicker back and forth that create my personality? Am I just an animal that has learned to do a few different things? Where do you come from? There's a big rock that you have to consider in your faith. Second question is, where are you going? Where you come from? Where are you going? And this is a bit on the morbid side, but yet it's one of those questions that everyone has to deal with. What happens next? Not tomorrow, but when life is over. Do you believe in heaven? Do you believe in hell? Do you believe that God's word is true when it describes that there is an eternal life? And it does matter in the decisions that we make. You see, when we take those big rocks and we put those questions in first, it helps to decide all the rest of our life, all the other things that go into play as far as who we are. Where you come from? Where are you going? Watched a TV show the other day, and in it, it was trying to communicate that everyone can make up their own heaven. whatever you want, because I'm probably not going to be real excited about the way that you want to do things. The good news is that God says, I've got all that taken care of. I've made a heaven, and I've made a place for you to be there. It's a big rock. You have to decide what you're going to do. Where you come from, where you're going, what makes you get up in the morning? No, Olivia, I am not going to call you 7 times when you're off at college. Just to make sure that you're out of bed and make it to class. Your mama will. That's not what the question's about, though. The question is, what gives you purpose in life? What causes you to get excited about living? What is it? Maybe it is accumulation of wealth. Maybe it is the comforts of life. Maybe it is, and you can fill in blank after blank after blank, but what I hope that you see with this illustration of the big rocks and putting the big rocks in first is that all the answers to these questions all come back down to the same person that we sang about, Jesus Christ. Is he the reason that you get up in the morning? Because Scripture reminds us that he has a plan and a purpose for our life, and that he's created us for that opportunity, and he has put us in certain families and with certain relationships so that we can make a difference for the Lord in that way. Where do you come from? Where are you going? What makes you get up in the morning? And the last question that helps with the big rocks is, what causes a person to change? I'm of the opinion that people don't change very much. I think in 20 years, class, you're going to be getting together, and you're going to be sitting down, and you're living the old memories, and you're going to look across the table that you, on the people that you've grown up with, and maybe you haven't seen in a while, and you're going to be able to pick right up in those relationships. Because people don't change much except there will be a few in your class, hopefully a lot in your class, hopefully some of you have already been there. But Jesus does an amazing thing on people's lives. You will see people who did not know the Lord, who get an understanding of the Lord, and their life will be completely different. Big rocks, where you come from, where you going, what makes you get up in the morning, what makes a person change? The answer to all those things are Jesus. The other scripture that was read this morning tells us the very same thing. Matthew chapter 6, 33 says, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you as well. What a great verse. What an amazing promise. But you understand that that verse and that promise is given in the context of worry, of anxiety. You want a buzzword today? Anxiety, worry. That's something that's a part of everybody's life. And Jesus is saying, don't worry. If you want to not worry, what you have to do is put the big rock in first. And the big rock is seek the kingdom of God. And when we put God first, he helps us with our anxiety. He fills us with a purpose that gives us a reason to live so that we can understand what it is that he's called. It's a simple verse. We've memorized it from long ago. But it's an important verse. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, not your own. If so, all these things will be given to you as well. Jesus then tells one last parable of dirt, a lesson that we can learn. And it's at the end of the Sermon on the Mount. He has gone through Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7, and has kind of given, if you will, an upside-down view of what religion should be. The people at the time had believed that religion was all about duties and all about works and all about the efforts that they could do to get to God. And Jesus was trying to show them that it's much deeper than the things that you do. It's not just about don't drink, smoke, or chew, or go out with girls who do. But that there is a motivation beyond those things that gives you the opportunity to decide whether or not you're a follower of God or not. Jesus says, oh, you said about being angry, but I tell you, if you have hatred in your heart, you got to be careful, that's sin. And he challenges us again and again through the Sermon on the Mount, and then it gets to the very end, the scripture that was read earlier. Jesus tells this little simple parable about dirt, well, actually, if you will, about a rock. He says, if anyone hears these words of mine and puts them into practice, it's like a man who builds a house on a firm rock, a firm foundation. And he says, get the picture. That house, the winds come up, the floods come up against it, storms hit it, it has all kind of impact against it. Life is not easy. Jesus is reminding us of that. But if our life is built on his word, the end result is that it stays firm. And then he gives us the warning. But if you don't hear the words, and if you don't put them into practice, you're like the foolish man who doesn't have a firm foundation and builds their house on sand. When the winds come, when the storms hit, and when the difficulties of life happen, the house falls. The challenge is this. Put the big rocks in first. And the big rocks are what's provided by the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the one who gives us the reason to live. He is the one who gives us hope for tomorrow. It's not because of anything that we have done, but it's all because of what he has done for us. And in our faith in a great big God, and a great good God, and a great powerful God, he draws us into his kingdom and calls us his children, not just while we're here on this earth, but also forever and ever. Remember where you came from? Clay County? Yeah. Dirt? From Jesus Christ, who is the purpose and the answer for life. We're going to close with a word of prayer. Oh, no, we're going to have a special. Girls, are you ready to come forward and listen?
One. staring out the window, that SUV, plain and saying, I can't wait to turn 18. She said, I'll make my own money, and I'll make my own rules. Mama put the car in park out there in front of school. And she kissed my head and said, I was just like you. You're gonna miss this. You're gonna want this back. You're gonna wish these days hadn't gone by so fast. These are some good times. So take a little look around. You may not know what you're about. You're gonna miss this. Before she knows it, she's a brand new bride in a one-bedroom apartment, and her daddy stops by. He tells her it's a nice place. She says, it'll do for now. Starts talking about babies and buying a house. Daddy shakes his head and says, baby, just slow down. Oh, miss this.
always knew this day would come. We'd be standing one by one with our future in our hands. So many dreams, so many plans. Always knew after all these years there'd be laughter, there'd be tears. I never thought I'd walk away with so much joy but so much pain. It's so
in your precious name, I pray. Amen. Thank you.